Hey there, and welcome back to our continuing coverage from Dice Tower Con 2018, the only convention that leaves your breath minty and fresh.
Mm, it's true.
Yes.
I'm sitting beside Zev, and it's very minty and fresh.
It's heavenly. Yes. And I'm so glad that you took the time to prepare, because you are going to be talking about a lot of games here. We are going to just boom, 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 look at all this awesome stuff that's coming out from WizKids.
I'm going to try my best. Absolutely.
Okay, that's all we ask. So where do you want to start?
I will do Star Trek Galactic Enterprises.
Mm-hmm.
This is a game where you are all Ferengi selling a bunch of items on Deep Space Nine. This is a re-implementation of a game called Fantasy Business, which was done many years ago. Same author, Christoph Bollinger. So in this game, first thing you do is we're going to be auctioning the items that we have for sale. And these are not individual items. Basically, assume that you have a store. So once you have the item, it's an in-stock item that you always have.
Okay.
So very simple thing, right? First thing's an auction to see who gets what. You say, let's the Dabo machines. There's your base price. We go around until somebody buys it. That's cool. So let's say we buy it. You know, let's say I got a Dabo machine. You get a pad. You get a Sentinel. Then on the next phase, we want to sell the stuff. So we have a price fixing sheet here. Mm. So when everybody has their own thing, it's very easy. You can sell for no less than the base value or no more than double the value. So my Dabo machine, I can't fix a price more than double. So I can't do more than 10. So very nice and simple, cool. Let's go to the next round. Let's assume now that you have a Dabo machine as well as I do.
Take that.
Now I can't just set a price myself. I have to go to you and say, hey, what would you like to set the price at, since we both have it?
Ah.
So it's like we can be friendly and go, hey, let's go 10. We're monopolizing the market, and we'll both get 10 Latinum, and you'll say, hey, sure, that's okay. But let's assume that it's not okay, but I don't know that. So let's assume I go, I put 10 here, but on his sheet he puts 8.
Undercuts you.
He undercuts me.
Yep.
Now, because I'm the highest, nobody buys from me, and they buy from you. And because you are the lowest, you also get a 2 Latinum bonus per card that you have of the Dabo machines. And that's the thing, it is per Dabo. So if I had 3 of these,
ooh,
even at 10, I would get 30, 10, 10, 10.
You're selling each one.
For you, you would get 8, 8, 8, let's say, but then plus 2, plus 2, plus 2. So, but it works that where I would have gotten nothing had you undercut. And that's where, you know, it gets even crazy, because let's say you get some Dabo machines. Now it's us three working together. Mm-hmm. So let's say I stick to the 10 plan, you go 8, but you go 6. So now they don't buy from me. They do buy from you, but you don't get the bonus. And they do buy from him, and he gets the bonus for being the lowest. That's really the game. It's a matter, we're all, again, Ferengi. Remember, deep down, everyone's Ferengi, and the motive for profit is profit. So that is a Star Trek. Also, we have action cards you can auction off as part of the market. And these are things that do crazy stuff. They can allow you to eliminate a card. They can change a card for another thing. It could change the way the auction is held, and so on and so forth. They could change the prices. So these are the crazy things that you can do, and you can actually use it as threats, saying, you know, if you go against me, this card is waiting for you.
So they're in your hand.
These are secret in your hand. Correct. These are out in the open. These action cards are a secret.
Okay.
So
and who's buying?
It's an ephemeral buyer.
It's not another person buying.
No. Okay. It's just we're price fixing it for the customers that are coming in.
And they're going to be selling.
Exactly. Okay. And then they just buy from the lowest or medium. They don't buy from the highest if there's a difference in price.
And we negotiate publicly, but then we secretly actually said...
Exactly. Yeah, so each one of us have this price fixing sheet. So we're like, all right, 10, 10, good. Okay. And then you go, and we go, hey, how much are we selling Dabo machines? I go 10. And he goes 8. We're like, man. So lots of backstabby goodness. It's for 3 to 8 players.
Oh, nice.
It is available, and it's $25.
That's very cool.
Do you get to teleport in and shoot anybody?
There is no shooting anybody.
Oh, but it's Star Trek. I was going to shoot somebody.
But this is the Ferengi selling version, not the starship fighting each other.
This is the economic. This is the economy the game in Star Trek. Okay.
Not the away team trying to make friends with people or whatnot.
Well, that's cool.
So that's Star Trek. Thank you. That is Star Trek Galactic Enterprise.
And you said up to 8 players with that one?
3 to 8 players, yes.
How long does it play?
It plays about 45 minutes to an hour.
And when how does the game end?
The game ends after a number of rounds. So you play either 8 turns if you're playing up to 8. If you have 3 to 6 players, you go 10 rounds.
Okay. Hand over fist.
Yes, and if you look the price figure, it tells you the number of turns. So you're going to set the prices for each turn. And again, 9 and 10 if you're playing 3 to 6 players.
I knew we were in trouble when right off the bat I noticed that instead of a price sheet, it's a price fixing sheet.
So you are fixing the price.
Your priority straight.
Absolutely.
All right. Next.
So we got Endless Pass over here. This is your Vikings.
Ooh.
So we have these. We have action cards and we have pass cards. everyone also plays Viking. We have a generic side of Vikings, and then we have some named Vikings, which have special abilities and alternate rules for how many cards you draw here and your hand size and actual cards. But in the generic, it's 3 and 3. So on your turn, you're going to draw 3 cards from the pass here, and your hand size of action cards is 3. What you're trying to do is defeat Endless to get glory. The game ends when somebody survives their turn with 10 glory, or they're the last Viking surviving.
Okay.
Again, glory, mostly you get from killing Endless, although you can battle other Vikings as well, and you can battle them for glory or health. That is the other thing. You can be eliminated. There's 10 health. You can drop down and be eliminated. But once that happens, the game starts folding in of itself and starting to end.
Kind of a domino effect.
Exactly, because it happens very quickly. So when you draw the cards, so I'm going to draw 3 cards from the past. So I go 1, 2, 3. I hold them in my hand, but I must reveal any Endless.
Okay.
Because those are the things I need to fight. Mm-hmm. This card is not an Endless, so it stays in my hand. And then let's say I have 3 cards over here, for example, as my action cards. So on my turn, I have to face them. I have 2 Endless here. The way to face them is I can try to fight them. A sword will kill an Endless, so if I do this, I eliminate it, I get a glory.
Okay.
All right, that's one way to go. The other thing is, man, let's say I don't have that sword, I can do an evade. Evade allows me to evade one Endless, so this thing will not damage me. Because at the end of the round, whatever at the end of the encounter, whatever Endless I've not avoided or killed will do damage to me.
Okay.
So this will do 1 damage to me. But here's the other thing. Also, because I didn't kill this, even though I don't take damage from it, when my turn is over, these will continue on to the next player.
Okay.
So when they draw cards, they're going to add any Endless to the pile that's coming at them.
Okay.
So there's a little bit of cooperation in that he's like, hey, I can send some stuff to you or not. But it's also a lot of competition where I can say, you know what, now you've got to deal with some extra Endless. So some of the other action cards, just to throw it out there, a shield will allow you to defend against 2 Endless, so they won't damage you.
Okay.
I could steal an item, meaning I could either draw another Endless card or steal an action card from a player.
Ooh.
Hide is a thing that I can do, but it takes my whole turn. And what it does is it makes the Endless, I don't have to face them. I don't draw any cards. I don't replenish my hand size. And I could change the order in which these turns.
Okay.
So it's like, hey, you're winning here. Now, you know what? These two are coming towards you. The other thing, as I said, we do, after you deal with the Endless, you can attack another Viking. And again, you can use swords. There's something called Greek fire you can throw at people. And these are things that when you say, I want to attack you, I say, I'm going to attack you for help or glory.
Okay.
And then the winner will get that reward as a result.
Okay.
It's a 3-6 player game. Takes about 30 to 45 minutes to play.
Okay. And how does the game end?
The game ends when someone reaches 10 glory and survives their turn, or they're the last Viking standing.
Oh, okay.
All right.
And is this out now?
This is out now. It's also $25.
Nice. Okay.
And it comes with 6 Vikings. These are just 2 of the sheets that I showed you, but it comes with 6 Vikings and something like about 155 cards or something like that.
Okay. So they're a good-sized deck there.
Yeah, yes, absolutely. So, all right, there's that. We got Maiden's Quest.
Ooh.
Maiden's Quest, we just flew in some copies here for this show.
Oh, yeah?
We had some at Origins. It will be available, I think, more in August, I believe.
Okay.
In this game, this is a handheld game. You don't need a table or anything. All the decks are in your hand. You're going to play like this. And you're going to fan out cards, and you're going to use the symbols on the cards. You are a maiden that's trapped in a tower. You're tired of waiting for somebody to rescue you, so you go out on your own. You pick up your dress, pick up whatever's in your room, and you start going down that tower. And the object is you're trying to either escape the tower or defeat your captor. In this thing, you make 2 decks that you put together. You're going to make your maiden deck, and then you're going to make the obstacle. The captor's deck. So you'll have like a bad guy. So in this case, we have here Turdo Wildenson.
Nice.
So she's going to be a captor, and they tell you how to make the deck. They tell you what obstacles to put in,
okay.
And the maiden also tells you what to put in for her. So you're going to start with a maiden. You're also going to pick a dress. This one is 1 dress of your choice. So we have dress cards that you can use. So as I said, I don't have a deck set up here, but again, you're going to use the symbols when you face an obstacle. The obstacle is these cards here. So this tells you the tower level. Anything of your tower level or below you can face or try to run from, but any that are above you, you can just ignore. They call cellaring. You just take it from the top of the deck and you put it on the bottom of the deck. So this one tells you the evil consort. You need 2 of the fantasy, the unicorn, the little wyvern griffin thing. Yes. So if you do that in your hand, so you'll have, again, a hand of cards, for example. This is a quick thing.
Okay.
So here, like, you'll have a hand of cards. So you're going to fan 5 cards. Let's say that's in your hand. So you're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you're going to look at the 5 cards here, and you're going to look for those 2 symbols. If you don't have them, then you failed. Failed here, this tells you you need to downgrade a card. So you're going to take one of your cards, mm-hmm. and you're going to downgrade it.
Oh, okay, that's
to
cool.
that side.
Ah.
Okay? Or if you succeed, let's say I was able to be there, you flip her over, and now I can upgrade a card. So I could take any one card, and I can go, look at that. So I went from here, went from, what was that, manicured nails, which has a sword and cunning, to perfect nails. And now I have a sword and 2 cunning. So this is going to be in my deck forever. So there's also ways you can take damage. When you take damage, you have to take a card with a heart symbol, and that's what you have to downgrade. The game also, you lose the game if you have to downgrade and you can't anymore because you're at the end. Because some cards go all the way down, like to the end side here. You'll see like a little broken slipper.
Yes.
That shows you it can't be downgraded anymore. And there are some cards that are just gray on the other side to show that they're done. But this is a game that you can play solo, mm-hmm. right? But you can also play 2-player. And even in the middle of the game, you can play multiplayer, co-op, competitive, and what we call serendipity. Serendipity is, let's say I'm playing the game, and you come up to me and say, hey, you know what? I need help with a vampire. Can you help me? I go, sure. And you say, Zev, you fan 3 cards, I'll fan 2 cards. We combine, if we can defeat the vampire, any reward, you can say, you know what? I got 2 upgrades, I'll take 1, you take 1. Hey, thank you very much.
Oh, wow.
And then you can also have these special cards that allow you to, first of all, there's also treasures that if that's one of the rewards, you go through your deck, look for a treasure, flip it over, and it becomes available.
Okay.
But there are cards that you can sign the back of, and I think I had seen some somewhere. Let's see, these are some dresses here. Right here. So let's say that you had this magnifying glass. You sign the card here. When you have 5 unique signatures, it now becomes a card that's active in your deck. So that's what you get for serendipity. It's like a gift. Hey, thank you for helping me. Here,
so you're actually writing on the card?
You're writing on these cards, and when you get 5
I don't like writing on my cards, Ziv.
Well, then you're not going to get this ability. And that's okay. You don't need that ability, but that's the only way to unlock this ability. Again, in this game, it's, again, we were friendly, right? Let's say I meet you up, and you say, hey, come on, you want to fight? You know, we'll do it. Yeah. So let's say we got these dragon wolves. So you say, I can defeat them in a fan of 4 cards. I can say, I can defeat them in 3 cards. And you say, you know what? Defeat those dragon wolves in 3 cards. And I take 3 cards and I see if I can do it. So that's how you fight, do competitive. You could do team going or cooperatively where you're all working together. And again, you can all go your separate ways and go back to playing solo.
Huh.
And this is the thing, you could play 30 seconds. So you could play one adventure mm-hmm. kind of thing. You fight the evil consort. It's my turn at the to order something. All right. Put it back, done.
Wow.
Huh. Also, you have these rest cards. When you meet a rest card, I don't know what the other one is, but right here. So you start at level 1, as I told you in the thing. So when you meet a rest card, you shuffle your deck, you go up a level. So you're going to go to 2A, 2B, then 3A, 3B, and then the last level is 4. So that's how you increase your level. As you're going down, when you meet the rest cards, you're doing that.
Huh. Wow,
so that's,
there's a lot going on in that little game.
Yeah, there's
yes,
a,
it is.
I was going to say, for being a little card, there's a lot packed in here.
Yes, you got about 160 cards, so it's enough to make 2 decks, so it's good for 2 players. And again, it goes co-op, competitive, solo, 2-player, team play, a group play, all in the same cycle.
So I want to go back to this card that you're signing. So,
go ahead.
You play enough to where you get all the signatures, then forever it's upgraded.
Correct.
Is that how it works?
Yes.
Okay. So it's not like a legacy aspect. You've got to play it enough to get it upgraded.
Yeah, so here's the brooch. So if I have the brooch, after we do the serendipity, I go, do you mind signing it? So again, boom, 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 you get the 5, and then the brooch becomes available, and now you get 2 wild symbols, which can help greatly. Facing some bigger guys.
No question about that. Does it have to be 5 unique signatures?
5 unique signatures.
Okay, so
you want to help people. You want to go out and help people.
You got to go seek out other players.
You have to go seek out other players.
That's clever.
Yeah, you don't want to just keep going back and forth and say, sign.
Yeah.
No, you want 5 unique signatures.
Yeah, that's an interesting social aspect to the game, right? It's like pulling a buddy. It's like, hey, would you mind playing this game with me?
Absolutely.
I like that.
Yeah. Let's get this magnifying glass.
And
again,
a deck is usually 30 or 40 cards, so you can just put it in your pocket and just pull it out when you want to play.
Yeah,
hey, I see you're playing that. Hey, you know what? I got my deck. Hey, let's go. Oh, I got a brooch too. So hopefully we'll sign when this is done. Dun, dun, dun. You do it. Let's sign.
So do you build your own custom deck?
You build, yes. According to, remember each thing here. So this tells you, for example, Priscilla of Icehold. She starts with 2 charisma cards and 5 random starting health cards. She has an heirloom. She has a great axe as an heirloom. She has 14 random items, which you'll put in deck, and dress, you pick one dress of your choice.
Okay, and then that's the deck you
and
play
that's,
with.
That's her deck. Well, that's her deck. Then you get the bad guy, this the captor. This one has 13 obstacles, two level two, five level ones, three, two, one, one treasure, three saviors, and then you combine the decks.
Okay.
Shuffle it together, shuffle it well, and then you're going to put the two rest cards behind the deck. And that's how you start. And also, if you ever meet your mace, and then you keep flipping cards. You sell her cards until you meet a maiden or an obstacle or the captor or I believe even, I don't know if a savior. I don't remember if you stop with a savior. But definitely if you meet your character, you'll get to do what she does. And usually she can upgrade one of these type of cards. But everyone is different. This one can upgrade swords. Gwendolyn of Bale Krua, she can upgrade a sword card in the end. So you would fan your cards, one, two, three, four, five, and any one sword there, you can take and immediately upgrade it because of her ability.
And then you gotta make sure they stay oriented that way, so the next time you play the
correct.
Deck, then it's the upgrades and everything are correct.
Right, yeah. When you start the game, you'll notice the crown here, so all the cards will be in the crown in the left side orientation. So, but as the game goes through, yes, you will have things in different orientations, but you do have to remember it. And we say, use the, there's a reference card. We say, use the reference card to show you the where the start of your deck is. So you would put it on the front of your thing. So you know when you pull it out, you go, oh yeah, that's my deck, not that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's that. So you put the reference card as a placeholder.
I'm very intrigued by this.
Yes, yes.
This went from like, okay, it looks like a little main game, and then the more you talk about it, it's like, wait, well, I want this.
Yes, yes.
And then you want to find other people that have it.
Yes, yes. It is a very, it's a deeper than looking game. Absolutely.
Yes, it is, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, you got all these symbols here and that, but once you learn it, we got a quick start guide. It gives you a sample, like 10 cards, 12 cards that you can play with to give you the idea. But yeah, the book, is, I mean, it's a hefty book, but only because it's a small size. But it gives you everything. But yeah, it is very deep. And the fact that you can do all those modes that I talked about is just icing on the cake.
All right, so give some details on this. How much does this cost?
$20.
$20 and it plays up to?
It can play multiple players because you can play it as all cooperative and just share. You know, hey, I'll fan a card, you fan a card, you fan a card, you fan a card. Boom, let's work together.
And then it plays up to, I guess, however long you want to
play. However you want to play, until you solve the, until either you lose because you can't downgrade anymore, or you've escaped the tower, or you've defeated your captor.
And then if once that happens, I guess you just reset the deck and go
again.
Make
a new deck. Yeah, make a new. We have 8 maidens, so you can do different maidens, and about 8 or 9 captors.
I assume each maiden has her own specialty?
Correct. Yep. They upgrade, see, they can upgrade different things. So this one upgrades the gem and that. This one does the shield and sword, and they also have like a special power usually on the back here as well.
So find one that fits your play style.
Yep, and they also start with different heirlooms, sometimes different starting healths. Also the dress of your choice, so you can always choose the dress that you want. So
what does the dress do?
They're all, well, here's you have an armored attire. Look at that. It gives you a shield to prevent some damage and a wild. Here we have a sundress. Sundress gives you a wild, a sun symbol, and the sapphire symbol. We have a royal gown. We have a working dress. So this is, here's a ballroom dress you can start with. All kinds of stuff going on here.
Let me see that box cover. So here's the thing. This is one of those that, this is why it's always good to go out and do demos and really look at stuff, because this, you'd see this box and you think it's kind of unassuming, it's like just another card game and you pass on, but then when you dig into it and you sit down and you go to a con, you have a chance to demo these games, you find that there's a lot more there than, I want to run over to this booth after this and get a copy of this. Does this sound
please do, because we
really
are selling
cool?
out, just letting you know.
Very intriguing.
I'm not doing that as a promotion thing, we are selling out.
It's already out in stores?
Nope, not yet. We flew some in for this show. We'll have some for Gen Con. It'll be in stores, I think, sometime in August. Or
okay.
September the latest. So it's only available right now at cons.
I know nothing about this game, and I'm already extremely interested in this game just from what I hear about.
Yeah, definitely want to keep
cool.
an eye on.
And especially at only $20.
Yeah. $20.
So it has a low entry, low barrier to entry to see if you want to. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. I appreciate your interest in it. Do we have time for one more?
No,
that's it.
The producer from behind the camera.
Producer, let us know their opinion.
But so. If you want to, you can just show us real quick what they are. I'm sure people are curious about this big box right here.
I'll do the quick box quickly. This is, we got SEAL Team Flicks. SEAL Team Flicks, I like to call it like an urban dungeon crawl. It's modern day You are a SEAL team going after some eco-terrorists. There are six boards in here that represent a subway, a hotel, a bank vault, a warehouse, and so on. You are SEALs. You got modern weaponry, HK MP5s. You got Bernelli shotguns, flashbangs. You got snake cams. You're going in the board. There are big boards here, basically roughly the size of this here. The flicks part is because you are flicking. When you shoot your weapon, you flick the bullets. And there are walls that you put on each of the boards so you can actually ricochet off the walls, hit tangos. Yep, the tangos have an AI system. They don't have a dexterity system. Only the SEALs do. You have two actions. There's also E-lock doors. So those are doors you got to hack open. And that's the other dexterity element. We have three sideboards, one of which is when you're trying, you'll see in the back here, like here. So you're going to have discs that cover like four or five or six numbers here, mm-hmm. and you have to flick to try to knock them off. And if you expose the numbers, you hack the door. This one is, a dexterity is you're trying to shoot the tango who's holding a hostage here. So you're trying to shoot and trying to get the red dot to get a
headshot. Without hitting the hostage.
Without hitting the hostage, yeah. And there are three levels. You have a rookie, a veteran, and an operator level. So they give you they scale the difficulty. So yeah, you got that. And then the other one is a bomb defusal sideboard where you have the disc over the colored wires and you have to knock them off to show that you've cut those colored wires.
Yeah. So glad. I saw this being. I saw your presentation during the Origins at the Dice Tower interview, and I was just watching it. And the one thing I didn't pick up was, is it possible to take friendly fire accidentally?
You can.
Oh man.
I don't play first person shooters.
Yes. Your SEALs can easily get killed in this, and friendly fire does happen, especially when you ricochet those bullets.
Okay.
So you got to be careful where you shoot.
All right.
So, yep, so there's SEAL Team Flicks, comes with a bunch of things here.
Yeah, and it is a hefty box,
And as a quick thing, is Spy Trick, this is from a Japanese game, we got the license for it. It was called Trick of Spy originally. It is a trick-taking game, but it's also a gambling game. You're trying to suss out the secret card. So after you deal out cards, there's one card you put as the secret document, and you have to guess as to what it is based on the cards that are being revealed and played, and then you're putting your guesses. So you're trying to guess either the suit, the rank, or if you're lucky, the rank and suit. So it plays, I think, in five rounds. It's three or four players, takes about 20, 30 minutes. You just keep scoring points. You play until, I think, everybody has had a turn, and whoever has the most points wins.
Cool. So you kind of start out with very little information. As the round goes by, you're getting more and more
information. Exactly, because as you're playing the cards, you go, we know it's not the white nine, for example, because he just played it, okay? Exactly. You know, you played yours, and then you have a winner loser card. So the winner gets to bet, then the loser gets to bet. So you get... and also loser gets a helper pawn that can double their score if they're right. Okay. But yes, as it's revealed, you get to suss out, wait, which one is it based? Because you also know what's in your hand.
Yeah.
So you have that plus as the cards that you're seeing being played. So it is slowly being eliminated as to what the secret document is, the secret card.
That sounds really cool.
That is out now, absolutely. Yeah, that one's out now. And SEAL Team is out now as well.
And what was the
cost?
This one's $20. SEAL Team is $60, I believe.
Okay, so $60.
$59.99. This one is $20. And we said before, Star Trek is out and Endless Pass is out. Maintenance Quest is the only one that's not currently out right now, except at shows.
There we go.
Fantastic.
Zev, thank you so much for coming on. We've got a lot of stuff coming out.
Yes.
Oh, I appreciate it.
And you probably got even more maybe coming at Gen Con.
At Gen Con, we will have about two or three new games, including Arrive. Game of Eldritch Contortions. It's Cthulhu Twister-ish.
I'm in. Yeah.
Cthulhu Twister. I'm in. Right tentacle. Red.
Yes. Yes.
Seventh tentacle blue.
Yes. It's a team game. One of you are the cultist. The other one is a great old one. And the cultist is beseeching the great old one as to where to place their appendages. And you're trying to form a pattern. On the grid, which they don't know, and you're trying to figure out.
Wow.
But here's the thing. It's almost hard for one great old one to do the pattern themselves, so anything that another great old one is touching could be used as part of the pattern.
Okay, that sounds like a wild party game.
It is very much a wild party game.
All right, so if people want to find out about all these games, where can they go find out?
I would say probably at WizKids.com is probably a good start. Also BoardGameGeek.com, mm-hmm. and just reviews as they pop up at different places like Dice Tower, and so on.
Okay, Zev, thank you so much
yep.
again.
Thank you for having me.
So check out their website, and you'll see, you go check out the stuff at your retail store, and if you're in Gen Con, you'll see some more stuff. And we're going to be back in just a couple minutes. We're going to take a short break and get ready for our next guest.